Hi, my name is Fabrice.
Because I really love how Arsenal back then, Arsenal Wenger. How is your relationship with Arsenal Wenger? How frequent he is watching the youth game? How frequent he give advices to use players?
With Arsenal, is a very obviously when I was there, the young player, it was very hands-on with so many stuff, so many other stuff. He doesn't speak much to young players, but when you go and train with him, and if you like what you see, he'll make sure you stick with the group. So Arsene Wenger is very, very, very intelligent in terms of his football knowledge. He knows how to speak to young players. He knows how to spot a good talent from distance, you know. And he gives youth player a chance. I think he was one of the first people in England, you know, besides Sir Alex, to literally bring in a crop of talent every single year. Mm-hmm. You know, I think Man United. On a Sunday, mm-hmm. it was mm-hmm. when they always have a youth team in the squad.
Yeah.
And Arsene Wenger was one of the guys who was thinking in that similar length of bringing young players in two ways, either to get into the first team and or even to value their marketing value to that, so that we know that even we can keep him or we can sell him.
Who is your best coach during your playing career? Who's your best midfield partner? And who is your best football friends?
Well, that's three questions. Okay, best coach first.
Okay. Best coach first. I think when I first left Arsenal, I went to Birmingham, I had Steve Bruce. Uh-huh. And then Steve Bruce knew how to get the best out of me mm-hmm. in terms of, because we played Saturday, Tuesday, what Steve Bruce used to do, he said, you know, say if in December we've got about 9 games, he said, if you give me good 6 games, I'll give you the free game off, so you don't have to be involved in it.
I see.
And in that way, I can train, but I know I'm not going to be involved because I'm resting to get myself ready for January. You know?
I see.
And in the beginning, I used to find it a bit weird, but when he explained to me in terms of the load management of the game, it was really beneficial to me because you don't want to go in there and play every single week and you burn out. Mm. You know. And I think that was the best advice and best manager that I enjoy playing with and got the best out of me, really. Yeah.
And then the best partnership, is it?
Best partnership, when I was at Bolton, I had a lad called Stuart Holden.
Stuart,
I just knew how Stuart played. Stuart, very attacking-minded player, but also can play defense. But I was more compliment to his game because I could do a lot of his, you know, the nitty-gritty stuff of it, and I make sure that he go in there and do all the pretty stuff, but it was enjoyable, not just as a player, but also as a person. Mm-hmm. Obviously, his career was cut short from an injury, but all in all, I think he had a promise to have a long, long career if he remained injury-free, and then I really enjoyed playing with him.
You remember Manuel Almunia?
Yes, Manuel, yes.
You know, we already know, but Manuel Almunia career be stopped because of the heart condition.
Yeah.
Have you contacted him?
I haven't seen Manuel for quite a while, to be honest, but I think with the heart condition, once you suspect you have an issue, the best advice will be the best advice, also the most difficult for the player to accept, is to walk away from the game. Because there's no time, you feel like your dream has been taken away from you, and you're ill but of something that you don't have no control of. Mm-hmm. It just is something that either it's in your gene or you're born with it. So. And with Emmanuel, I felt for the guy because he had a long career ahead of him, but he had to stop because of the heart condition. And also, it's good for the club to notice it. That way, everybody is protected at the same time.
On that note, though, sorry, just wanted to bring it up a little bit. When you decided to actually retire from football, how hard was it for you to actually come to that conclusion? And then how did you move forward with that? Because you've done a lot of things afterwards in terms of you went to management school, you did your journalism course as well. So, what
motivated
you?
I think that was probably the most difficult pill to swallow because I had hope that I would come back and play. Mm. That's me thinking, well, it's only an accident, but surely there's a medication or there's a treatment out there that can help me and get my heart, you know, get better again. But the longer I stayed in hospital, the more I started to question, so well, this might be the end of me, you know. I think a lot of people knew it was the end of me, but they never really told me about it. They just tried to protect me from, you know, the whole what's going on. And I had to see 3 specialists, and those 3, if one of them said they can cure my condition, then I'll be able to go back and play, say he's exactly, able to do it. I went to see a specialist in London, Professor Schilling, who did my surgery, and he said, Fabrice, advise you not to go back. I went to see a guy in Belgium called Pedro Bugrada, who created the pacemaker that everybody has. Mm-hmm. Again, he literally said, you know what? Those 2, I wasn't really interested to see the 3rd person, because those 2 alone, if those 2 can't do anything to you, then you're like, what's the point? Mm-hmm. And they saying that to me. I remember when, you know, Pedro said, you know, it's best for you to call a day. I literally cried for a whole day. I just cried. But I'm glad it happened the way it happened, because I got to be able to see my kids and get to enjoy life a bit more. And I get to meet you too, you know?
Maybe you can start off by telling us a bit about your story and how you moved to England and got into the Arsenal Academy.
So I moved to England when I was 18 years old. 11 years old, but my father came before me as an asylum seeker in England. Yeah,
from Congo.
From the Congo.
Yeah, yeah.
And I came to England, didn't know a word of English, literally. Like, all I knew was, hello, how are you? Because in the Congo, we learned the basic of English, but we didn't really go into detail with it. And what happened is that, you know, football wasn't really like a priority in our household.
Yeah.
It was more of a, as most African parents would do, is that I want you to, you know, to come to England, study, do well, and be educated and do something different. Be a businessman or be a doctor or be somebody in society, you know. And football wasn't really like a big thing to my, you know, in our household. But however, in the Congo, I just played football a lot. Okay. And when I came to England, I played, but I wasn't, I played, but because of the equipment that England had, it was completely different.
Yeah.
You know, the quality of the ball, the boots, and you know, all that kind of stuff, because it took me a while to get into that kind of rhythm.
So just to touch on the time in the Congo,
yeah.
Is it like the stereotype street football that people imagine?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's definitely a bit full. There's the ball, and we can just go and play, go enjoy yourself. And with me, I was fortunate enough that when I was in school, we had a school team, it was great. But in year 9, we had a guy who came from Sierra Leone. His name is Rashid.
Okay.
But he was that good, yeah. You know, Arsenal took him straight away.
Yeah.
But with Rashid, because he wasn't interested with schoolwork. I was more into schoolwork.
Okay.
So we struck a deal. I said, Rash, I'll do most of your homework and stuff like that.
Wow.
And you can try to get me into Arsenal. So I never got scouted.
Okay.
Like, you know how people get
asked? Great story.
Never, ever, ever got scouted.
Yeah.
Never. Yes.